Today, we gather as an online community, united by one voice, to worship and praise our Lord and Savior.
Last week, Elisha spoke on the different types of love and expanded on the agape love that God has for each one of us. That God's love is unconditional and sacrificial. Elisha focused on our love for God and for others, and how love can be a strong uniting force which identifies us as believers and followers of Jesus. Jesus's love identifies us within the kingdom of God, with the Holy Spirit connecting us all together. Now, this got me thinking about the Father's love, Jesus's love, and the Holy Spirit's love. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, commonly referred to as the Trinity. And as I pondered the topic of love and related this to the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I summarized my thoughts into the following. So the Father's love, He sent His Son. So for God so loved the world that He sent His only Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish but have eternal life. That's John 3:16. Most of us are familiar with that. Then Jesus' love, He died for me. So live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave Himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. That's Ephesians 5 verse 2. Then the Holy Spirit's love, He stays with me. 1 John 4:13 says, and He has given us His Spirit within us so that we can have the assurance that He lives in us and that we live in Him. So if you think about it from that aspect, you are loved from all sides, totally covered and surrounded by the love of the Trinity. How awesome is that thought and that reality? And will you ponder long enough to let that reality sink in so that you are able to live out each and every day knowing that you are loved? A father's love is a love that we all crave. His recognition, His attention, His stamp of approval, and God offers that with open arms to all who will receive. St. Augustine says, God loves each one of us as if there were only one of us. And then Billy Graham says, Jesus offered His love on the cross. When Christ hung and bled and died, it was God saying to the world, I love you. We often model our understanding of God the Father on how our human father was, which is natural. We are designed to have a father figure in our lives. Even Jesus had Joseph as His earthly father. Maybe you were lucky enough to have an amazing dad, and that is fantastic. But perhaps your view was tainted, as we all have our flaws. But God. But you, O Lord, are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. That's Psalm 86, verse 15. God, as Father, is merciful, gracious, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Jesus offers the best and greatest gift of all, His undying love, which extends into the gift of eternity. So live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave Himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Ephesians 5:2. So to quote St. Augustine again, he says, what does love look like? It has hands to help others. It has the feet to hasten to the poor and the needy. It has eyes to see misery and want. It has ears to hear the sighs and sorrows of men. That is what love looks like. Jesus replied to those who asked him, he says, love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind. These are the first and greatest commandments. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. And that's from Matthew 22. And then the Holy Spirit. I'm going to quote from 1 John 4:13. And he has given us his Spirit within us so that we can have the assurance that he lives in us and that we live in him. Romans 5:5, the Apostle Paul spoke words of encouragement to believers saying, the love of God has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. The Holy Spirit makes the love of God so abundant in the believer's heart that it overflows. He is the divine agent who expresses the love of God to the believer. Abiding in God's love is made possible by the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. That's 1 John 4, verse 13. So what a privilege to have God abiding in us. We have God's Spirit living in us as a permanent resident. Let's give him, the Holy Spirit, permission to settle down and make himself completely at home in our hearts. We abide in his love and we experience the abiding of God within us. So I'm just going to share a little story with you to help us understand the love of the Trinity. In 1919, after the end of the Paris Peace Conference, then Emir Faisal, along with his staff from the Arabian Peninsula, traveled with Lawrence of Arabia to London. During their stay at the Ritz Hotel, they were amazed at the running water to which they had access. These men wanted to remove the magic faucets from the hotel because they thought that if they took them with them to the Arabian Peninsula and elsewhere, they would always have instantaneous access to hot and cold water, simply by turning the handles. They failed to realize, however, all of the detailed engineering behind those faucets. This story helps to illustrate that we do not always understand how something works, and therefore we are prone to draw our own conclusions, which could be faulty or misleading. But as believers, we can safely say that we have truly experienced God's love in tangible ways, just as these Bedouins experienced the benefits of running water while they were staying at the Ritz Hotel. But have you ever related love into your ponderings of the Trinity? So in the same way that these Middle Easterns thought that if they removed the faucets from the hotel, they would still have access to hot and cold water, too many times we think and speak of God's love as if it is independent of his being a part of our Trinity or the Trinity. So God is love. In 1 John 4 verse 8 and 16, we read those words, God is love. This simple statement, which is a profound revelation of God's nature, all of the attributes of God, and of all the attributes of God, love is the most comprehensive of them all. There are two passages in Scripture which sufficiently illustrate this. The first example is found when Jesus was asked about the greatest commandment, which I've already shared with you. So out of the hundreds of commandments that were given, Jesus responded that the most important were to love God and then to love others. So from this, it is apparent that love is the all-encompassing attribute of all of God's commands. The second passage is found in 1 Corinthians 13. Love is explicitly described as the most comprehensive attribute. It is stated to be the greatest, 1 Corinthians 13, verse 13. And without love, even the performing of miracles or sacrificing one's life are described as nothing or a clanging cymbal. The Amplified Version shares with us, but have not love, which is love for others growing out of God's love for me, then I have become a noisy gong. I don't think any of us would like to be a noisy gong. So, the greatest expression of God's love, since everything that God does is based in love, any numbers from Scripture could be used here to further explain. However, let us consider the greatest expression of His love, namely the sending of His Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. But God demonstrated His own love towards us, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than that, now having been justified by His blood, we shall be saved from the wrath of God through Him. For if, while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of His Son, much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by His life. By this, the love of God was manifested in us, that God has sent His only begotten Son into the world, that we may live through Him. In this love, not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins. That's 1 John 4, verse 9 to 10. So here we see a repeated reference to God's Son, or the Son of God, in the context of the greatest expression of His love. This reveals to us that at the very least, there is a distinction between God and His Son, which also implies that God is the Father. It also reveals to us that God's love cannot be separated from this unity of the Father and the Son. There is an eternal love between the Father and the Son. So we can also see that relationship of love to the unity within the Father and the Son's relationship in the events leading up to God's greatest expression of love, which is the cross. In the evening prior to Jesus' crucifixion, Jesus spoke of His love for the Father, but also that the world might know that I, Jesus, love the Father, and I do exactly as the Father has commanded me. John 14, verse 31. Jesus also spoke of the Father's love for Him. He says, Father, I desire that they also, whom You have given Me, will be with Me where I am, so that they may see My glory, which You have given Me, for You loved Me before the foundation of the world. That's John 17, verse 24, if you'd like to look that up. This highlights the relational love between the Father and the Son, which has existed from the beginning of time. God the Father, Jesus the Son. This love is also mentioned by the Father when He declared at Jesus' baptism and His transfigurations, when He said, "This is My beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." At both these times in Scripture, the Father spoke audibly, highlighting the significance of that relationship. We move on to the Holy Spirit and love. There are several passages in the Bible that speak of love in relation to the Holy Spirit. I found this fascinating, as I must admit, it was not something that I had thought of before. But in Romans 15, verse 30, he says, "I urge you, believers, by our Lord Jesus Christ and by the love of the Spirit, to join together with me in your prayers to God." This acknowledgement of love to the Spirit is therefore also highly significant with respect to the Trinity. We are then encouraged to always include the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Whenever Scripture speaks of divine love, as here the Trinity is implied, if not explicitly mentioned. So the following two passages indicate the source of divine love in the believer's life that comes from the Holy Spirit. The first is Romans 5:5. And hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. And then we go to Galatians 5, verse 22 to 23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. Another passage that strongly implies the Holy Spirit as the source of divine love is one that we've already mentioned in 1 Corinthians 13. This descriptive chapter about the nature of love is placed in the midst of instructions on the supernatural gifts of the Holy Spirit, which are mentioned in chapters 12 and 14 to either side of 1 Corinthians 13. The implication is that just as the Holy Spirit is the source of these gifts, He is also the source of love, which surpasses all the gifts. And He goes on to say, apart from which there's nothing. So I'd just like to conclude. Within the Trinity, you have the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Unity is shown alongside relationship and love. The name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit is the way in which believers are baptized, and it is a public declaration of your faith when you are baptized. And we say, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Trinity reveals to us that God is relational and His love is real. It encourages us to be in relationship with Him, loving Him in return, and expressing that love to others. So, in summary, the Father's love, He sent His Son. Jesus's love, He died for you. Holy Spirit's love, He stays with you. You are surrounded by the love of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You are loved from all sides, totally covered, and surrounded by the love of the Trinity. So I'm going to go into a quote here. Let me tell you how worthwhile you are. You are infinitely valuable to God. First, God created you. Second, Jesus died for you. Third, He put His Spirit within you. Fourth, He wants you to be with Him forever in eternity. That is how valuable you are to God. You are infinitely valuable to God. Shall we pray together? Heavenly Father, thank you for loving me enough to send your Son Jesus to die for me. Jesus, thank you for your sacrificial love and dying on the cross so that I may have the gift of eternal life. Holy Spirit, thank you for being my constant companion and guiding me daily. May I show divine love to those around me through my actions and my words in the weeks to come. Heavenly Father, we give you honor and glory and praise in Jesus' name. So we do wish you a great week and the week ahead, and walking alongside Jesus, just knowing that you are loved, you are surrounded, and you are known. God bless. We pray that you would have a great week, knowing that God your Father is with you every step of the way.